the strength of unity. You know the stories of the friendship of David and Jonathan. You know how they touched one another's lives in powerful ways. And today we're going to look at one of those stories of Jonathan. And we actually are able to see a lot of distinguishing values between he and his father, King Saul. And we're going to see that Jonathan, by far, had more of a heart to follow the Lord than King Saul had, especially at this particular point. The Philistines had really been a terror to the Israelites. They had continued to mount up against them, and King Saul was not always obedient to the Lord, and this brought about even further punishment from the Lord as they were going to be harassed by this Philistine army. And what has happened over the course of leading up to this text, the people's heart had become melted as wax. And you're going to see with King Saul, there's only about 600 men when they had quite a larger army than this, but they began to kind of do like water. They took the path of least resistance and they got out of there. So many people had forsaken even the post that God had told them that they would already have the victory. They just had to be faithful. And King Saul acted a lot of the time in fear. And we're going to look at the direct opposite of that, which was in his son, Jonathan, who acted out of faith and courage and what God did. But the overarching theme of the message is going to be the unity that you see between Jonathan and his armor bearer. So if you've got your copy of God's Word, we invite you to turn to 1 Samuel chapter 14. And once you've found your place there in God's Word, we invite you to stand to honor and to reverence the reading of God's holy and inspired Word. 1 Samuel chapter 14, we'll begin reading in verse 1. Now it came to pass upon a day that Jonathan, the son of Saul, said unto his young man that bare his armor, "Come, and let us go over to the Philistines' garrison that is on the other side." But he told not his father. And Saul tarried in the uttermost part of Gibeah under a pomegranate tree, which is in Hebron. And the people that were with him were about 600 men. Heavenly Father, we pray that today as we read and study your word, that you would speak to our hearts, that this would be your words and not somebody's opinion. Heavenly Father, we pray for cleansing, that we may hear you clearly, and that we not only let it stop with taking it in our hearts, but Father, we would become doers of your word as well. Speak to us, Heavenly Father, on the subject of unity and the strength that there is when God's people come together in unity, and when your spirit is present and leading and guiding, that great things can happen. And we pray that, Heavenly Father, if there be any here today who are lost or who have not made that commitment to you or looking for a church family, that Heavenly Father, you would speak to their hearts, and that today would be the day of salvation, the day of commitment to serve you along with this church. And again, Heavenly Father, for those who are watching on the internet, I just pray that you would bless them, speak to their hearts as they watch on the computer, Heavenly Father, and that may we place this in our heart that we may not sin against you. In Jesus' name, amen. We have kind of an old saying there in Wiggins, we joke around and call ourselves the Wiggins tribe or whatever. But sometimes we would do little gutsy things. Sometimes they're mischievous, sometimes they were not or whatever. But sometimes we do these little things and it would kind of require us to have some guts to us, you know, some gusto. And so we kind of had a way of pepping each other up. And it usually went something like this. The person that was going to lead whatever charge it was would say something to the effect of, "Are you with me?" And the person's response to that, or the group's response, was, "I got your back." And then whoever's leading the charge would say, "Let's go." So it was a concept of making sure that the other person had our back. "Are you with me? I got your back. Well, let's go. Let's go take care of whatever it is." And sometimes it led to mischief, and sometimes it led to good things. But still, sometimes we have to kind of get a little bit of guts behind us to do some things that we want to be able to do. And it's always easier, it seems like, when we have companionship and unity there to do it with. And so I wanted to speak to you as we're preparing our hearts for communion about the subject of unity. And so the first thing I'd like to mention to you, we find that unity grants companionship. We'll see that unity grants text, as we read there in verse 1. Now it came to pass, this was a certain day. The actual Hebrew text there says, and it was this certain day. It basically lets us know that this is an ongoing part of the story that's taking place, where King Saul has been disobedient and paralyzed by fear. It's been so bad that even his army has lost heart and deserted him, except for 600 that are with him under a pomegranate tree. And if you were to study the geography of this, they're actually kind of the dead opposite to the uttermost part of the other side, staying away from the Philistines rather than engage them. Now, God had already promised them the victory books and books ago in your copy of God's Word, but years and years ago in their history, God had said, "You're going to overtake your enemies. Trust in me. I'm going to give you the victory." King Saul looked at the odds, and as the scripture says, you couldn't even count them. It was like sand on the seashore. There were so many of them. They had so many horses and so many chariots that from the human perspective, it seemed like an impossibility. But what Saul had forgotten and gotten away from was that God himself was the one who said, "I'm going to give you the victory. You go out and be faithful, and I'm going to take care of the rest." And King Saul forgot that, and it led to a disobedience. It led to a lack of faith, and it led to it being contagious throughout his whole army that they ended up basically deserting him. Now, it gets so much to the point, he's so stressed out, he doesn't even realize that his own son, Jonathan, is missing this morning. Now, I'm not like that in a year or anything. For the sake of my imagination, stay with me. We're in a war. The enemy's not too far from us. I'm numbering my kids. Like, I'm the guy at the mall. When we go to the mall, I stay behind like 3 feet and make sure I count four, and my wife there five. I make sure. Somebody goes to the store, I'm like, wait here. And we sit there and watch so they get through and they come out. I'm making sure the kids are counting. King Saul has a son here who is believed to be like an older teenager, very young man. And in the midst of this war, this is the son of the king. Right? Pretty important. He doesn't even know his son's missing. Sometimes fear and that lack of faith can paralyze you to a point where you don't even realize what's going on around you. And when we're in the midst of that heat, of that battle, and we get discombobulated, if you would, and we fail to even know the basics of things, the basic things to do, the things that we should be taking care of or normally would be taken care of, we get bewildered and we lose those things which are important. I see this happening in churches all across America as people are talking about numbers decrease of people that are attending church, or people that are tithing in church, or people that are serving in church, or people that are giving their life to missions or giving their lives to serve God in ministry. And the numbers look like they would get you depressed and get you down. But here's what I would say to this. Hasn't the church gotten so complacent for years and now got to a point of fearfulness that we just will allow anything to go on in the church just as long as somebody will come? That is the fear that is speaking there, not the faith. Jesus said, "If I be lifted up, I will draw all men unto myself." And yes, he was speaking of the kind of death he was going to die. But I do believe that it's also true of this statement. When the church is faithful to lift up the glorious gospel of Jesus Christ, God will draw people unto himself.
Amen. Yes.
What we do is we water things down, or we try to preach on a hotter topic, or we try to make sure that we're looking more like this part of society, or we're trying to... Folks, don't lose your post. Don't lose your grounding. Don't lose those things which are basic just because you're in the midst of a battle or a war, or it looks like you're going to be defeated by the human eye. Don't forsake the things that you know to do. Sooner or later, God will bless and turn it around. These Philistines, they had been harassing these Israelites for some time. But God had told them, and one of the places back in Deuteronomy, I'm scared I'm going to tell you wrong, somewhere around 28 verse 7, something like that. God had said, look, these enemies are going to fall before you. God had given this promise before King Saul was ever even born. But they had forgotten. through the eyes of fear rather than the eyes of faith.
Whenever he goes by,
what you're going to see here is these Philistines had lifted up this garrison, this place, this little band of warriors that were here, and they were not too far
to the side
away from God's people.
It's just from memory. It's not on.
And Jonathan, in verse 1, that came to pass upon a day that Jonathan, the son of Saul, said unto the young man that bare his armor, come and let us go over to the Philistines' garrison that is on the other side. But he told not his father. There's a couple of implications there. Number one, it seems that Jonathan knew that his father was in rebellion to God and was living a life of fear rather than faith. It also is very likely that under those circumstances that, you know, his dad wouldn't let him just go up there and take a whole garrison by himself. Jonathan is actually acting more like the godly king than his dad, King Saul. King Saul should have been the one that was doing what Jonathan was doing. But since he was not, God raised somebody up who would.
Yeah.
Now, I'm going to say something here, and it's going to sound brutal. But I'm telling you the truth, and I'm telling you out of love, and I'm telling you out of Scripture. Do not think that when you step out of sight, or that you step to the side and you no longer want to render your service to God, don't think that he won't raise somebody up to do your job. Don't think they're the only one that's going to serve God. And this is a thing that we have to, as pastors, that we really have to focus on. There are times where you say, well, they ought to start without me. You know, we kind of have that mentality. But here's the truth of it, though. We should never enter into ministry positions that way. It is a privilege to serve God. And sometimes we get a haughty spirit about us and say, well, you know, it's not going to go as well since I'm not there. I understand this. God talked through a donkey one time.
Amen.
You remember Jesus rebuked to the Pharisees, look, these people don't praise me, the rocks don't cry out. God doesn't need you. And I'm going to tell you something else, too, that may be a kind of a shock. God doesn't need me either. God doesn't need me. God chooses to use me because of his mercy and his grace and his kindness. He allows me to be used of him. But understand this, when we give our service, and this is anything to do with faithfulness, whether it is our time, whether it is resources, whether it's financial, whether it's you come here to the church and say, well, I gotta go to the Lord. Understand this. God loves a cheerful giver. We know this from the New Testament. And it's not just talking about finances, but finances are a part of it as well. And I'm telling you, we've got to get to a point, church, where we recognize that it is the privilege of serving God. It's the privilege of serving God that motivates us. And when you look at it through that lens, you're excited. I've talked to people about football, as you know, over the last year, or a couple of years now, there's been quite a controversy even in the NFL, and there's been drastic drops in numbers and things like that. And talked with family a little bit here, because we all watch football for years, and you know, made the statement that years ago I began to prefer college football anyway to the NFL, and that is true, and I still do as of right now. It's just people would ask, well, why is it? What was it exactly? And I said, I don't know. It seems like when they run out on the field when they're playing college, you know, they're trying to earn that spot. They feel privileged to be a part of that team. They made that team. They're a part of that team. And so they feel proud to wear the school's colors and things like that. And I said, it just seems like the NFL. You know, the rookies may play like that, but once they've been in 2 or 3 years, it's like the media owes them something if they walk out on the field. And I said, I just don't like that attitude anymore. But I don't want to be that honest with you. I don't think that's just an NFL. I think it's a church. They were to be proud that I'm their Sunday school teacher. Really? They were to be proud that I go up there and do this. Folks, let me tell you something. If you're serving with that kind of attitude, number one, know that it's very common and it can happen to anybody, including you. including me. Number two, notice that pride's going to go before you fall. Pride will go before you fall. What's funny?
It's not up there.
I believe that preachers have to face this because we're in that public limelight so much, and we're in the pulpit that much.
No.
And I believe that also those who would have to work through this or deal with this would be those who lead in worship. Because they're out there. If my voice is good enough, everybody's going to listen. That'll be good enough, right? And you can lean on your own talent. Well, first off, you wouldn't have talent if God didn't give it to you. There's been more than one who have lost their ability even to sing. So you need to know, unless God gives it to you, you can't do this. I dare say this, that we become prima donnas in the church, and we even get to the point where we don't invite even the Holy Spirit to come anymore. Jesus told us, where two or three are gathered in my name, there will be in the midst of them. And yes, I was talking about in matters of proof of innocence or guilt. Yes, I was talking about that, but you need to understand too. God has taken at times a handful or sometimes even one and done great things. Jesus didn't always go and call the crowds to be the one that were going to do the heavy lifting. He would take two or three to the side. He'd take 11 to the side. And understand this, it was a privilege to follow Jesus then, and it's a privilege to follow Jesus now. We lose sight of that. One of the things that I believe that hinders this is unity. When we fail to come together as a unit, we're not as encouraging to others, we're not as lifting up toward others, not as kind toward others, but unity grants a certain companionship. Now look at Jonathan and the armor bearer here. The armor bearer was most likely even a little bit younger than Jonathan at this point. So they're doing a little bit of dreaming. Look at verse 2. Saul carried to the uttermost part of Gibeah under a pomegranate tree, which is in Migron, and the people who were with him were about 600 men. They dwindled to that. Now, where you would have the king, you would think you'd have some of your strongest army, right? He had 600. They were up against impossible odds. It says, "In Ahiah, the son of Ahitub, Ichabod's brother, the son of Phinehas, the son of Eli, the Lord's priest, in Shiloh, wearing an ephod, and the people knew not that Jonathan was gone." Now, to give you just a little bit of here, this sounds like it would be a good thing because the priest is here to do his priestly duties. He's got this ephod on representing the Lord. But I would take you through and tell you this is a little too much, a little too late. If you go back and you look, Saul has already been doing things apart from what the Lord had said. Saul had already been disobedient. He'd even offered sacrifices before the prophet Samuel had gotten there to do it and to do it properly. And if you look here, it seems like this guy, Ahiah, and it gives a little bit of his lineage there, which means something, by the way. Ahiah is there wearing his ephod, so that means that the presence of the Lord is going to be there. But let's look at that lineage a little bit. This is where you can skim over something in Scripture and not see it's important, but I believe it's very important. The son of Ahitub, Ichabod's brother. Ichabod was the one that when he was born, his mother died giving birth to him and closing her last words were to name him Ichabod, saying the presence of God has departed. The Ark of the Covenant had been taken, and she named her son, the Spirit has departed. Okay, so this is not a good thing. You get where I'm going? And then it said, Ichabod's brother, the son of Phinehas, the son of Eli. Phinehas and Hophni, do you remember their positions? And do you remember what they did with it? Let's say they were not faithful to God, okay? They may have had the position, but they were not faithful to God. You can have a religious position, even a title. You can have more degrees than a thermometer and still not be faithful to God. So Ahiah is here, and he's representing the Lord. He's got the ephod on. Well, at least he's there to represent the Lord. little too much, a little too late, and the people knew not Jonathan was gone. What he does, Jonathan takes matters into his own hands and has the kind of faith that God wanted all along. He goes strictly to his armor bearer. He says, "Go over, let us go over to the Philistines' garrison that's on the other side." Now, part of this, in order for it to work, was going to be the secrecy of it. So that's part of why he didn't tell his father or any of the army, because the only way this was going to work was if it was a surprise kind of thing. Some have even led or alluded to that this was a possible assassination, that Jonathan was going to assassinate some particular person. That's not necessarily in here, although that's not totally out of the question. But this was a secretive mission at this point. But I want you to see this. Jonathan was granted companionship with his armor bearer. You know when I do the worst in ministry? Being dead honest with you. The first thing you would think of was, well, when he's in sin or whatever. Well, you don't necessarily have to fail to have a dry season in ministry. Sometimes you persevere in those hard times. But you know when ministry is the hardest for me is when I'm going it alone. When I'm the only one. I'm not saying it's not God doing it for you. Don't do it. But listen, God didn't design us that we would be doing his work by ourselves. There are seasons where we would go. You saw in the story of Philip and the eunuch, you know, he goes down and he's there. He's with you. There are seasons where you're called to do something like that. But understand, the book of Hebrews says very, very, very clearly, let us not forsake the assembling of ourselves together as the manner of such are. The point is, God created us to have fellowship with brothers and sisters in Christ, that we would be an encouragement one to another. Amen. We will dwindle spiritually when we miss church. Now, don't take this and say, well, Pastor's saying if I go on vacation that I'm in sin. Listen, understand this. I'm talking about for an extended time. I'm talking about for an extended season. I'm talking about playing hooky. It is true. We are people of habit, like it or not. And when we establish in our homes the habit of we're getting up and we're going to Sunday school, the kids don't have to get up and ask, Mom, do I get ready this morning? admit to this. People will walk down the aisle if they like a sermon, and they'll join up and they say, okay, this is where I'm going to be, and then you won't see them for years. Or people get burnt out and they forsake their post rather than going and kneeling before God and saying, you've got to strengthen me, I'm running dry here. Or people get feelings hurt and they walk out, they walk to the side. God created His people to be a unit. And some of the time we can't take on the big projects that God wants us to do because we don't encourage one another. I would dare even say this. Sometimes we even brace going to church because we know we're going to get discouraged if we go to church. Nobody wants to admit this, right? It's true. But when there's a unit there, when there's a God-centered focus, when there's a mission at hand, what happens? The church will start pulling together, and at least the core people will get together with the victory and get things worked out to make sure that the greater good is accomplished, right? And then we see things, tasks happen that we never thought we could have done. God has placed unity in our lives to generate courage for us. This garrison, we don't even know how many people were there. They were of skilled men. They had weaponry. This was not just a group of farmers that were sitting out there with a piece of bahia grass out there shooting the breeze a little bit. These were skilled fighters. These were battle-worn soldiers that were there with weapons, and they had better weapons than Israel had. And Jonathan says to his young armor bearer, come on, we're going to get him. And the guy says, just like your heart's with you, Jonathan, I'm going to be with you. You're backing up if you're waiting on me. Let's go. Two people. A whole garrison. We don't have many Jonathans in the church anymore that stand up and say, let's go get him, preacher. Instead, we got a lot of King Sauls that sit back up in the pomegranate tree and say, oh my goodness, we're going to church is supposed to be a place of unity. this world is lost and dying. And unless the church gets on mission, there's not a lot of hope. I was privileged the other day, it was Thursday, after lunch, and I met with Pastor Fred and Nora from Filipino congregation, and had a couple of other pastors from the Philippines that were with me, Dan Gonzalez, and Pastor Richard Feliz of Shining Hope Baptist over in the Philippines, and I got to meet with them. They have a wonderful ministry, and they have difficult ministries. But Pastor Richard said something to me. We were about to close in prayer. They were going to be leaving. And here I was trying to be encouraging to them. I know some of the struggles, not all, but I know some of the struggles. And they struggle. They struggle. This church doesn't struggle. They struggle. It choked me. To a point I had to face conviction myself. Here I am, I'm trying to be an encouragement to them and tell them, you know, keep on preaching, keep on being faithful, keep on. They were so gracious, they were so happy that we met for a little bit, so kind. And we're joining hands to pray, and Pastor Richard looks at that and he says, Pastor Josh, just please know that there's a church in the Philippines who are praying for you and your family and your ministry. I said, God, help me. Here I am, I'm supposed to be the encourager. I'm supposed to be the one that's helping them get back in the fight. To continue to put their hands to the plow, even when it costs everything. And he looks at me and says, just know that there's a church back in the Philippines that's praying for you and your family and your ministry. I can't tell you. I couldn't even lead in prayer. It took a minute for me to get my thoughts together. Is, have you been taking an approach when it came to church, when it comes to ministry? Like King Saul, where you're just going to sit under the tree, circle the wagons, and watch them even leave. Lose it all. Or are you going to be the Jonathan that wakes up even before daylight, so you creep out of there because you're so excited? And you grab somebody and you say, let's go win the war. I believe if I'm not, I don't want to be outside of God's will here, but I believe that at times the people of God are more content to sit under the palm branch and let a couple other Jonathans run the race. And I don't want that to be the case here. You still have purpose. You still have reason. You still have mission. And by golly, you still have victory. You just have to seize it. We're going to have a time of meditation where we'll prepare our hearts before we partake of the Lord's Supper together. I'm going to ask our praise team and our prayer warriors to come down. It may be that you'd like for somebody to pray with you. Maybe that you need some encouragement, you want somebody to pray that God will strengthen you. Let us pray with you. It may be that God's calling you to join a good church family that's going to be on mission for Christ. Lift his name up here. We'd love to have you. It may be that you've never asked Jesus to be your Savior, so having the victory is not something you're even sure about. Today you can be sure about having the victory through him that has loved us. And that's Jesus. He died and rose again that we would have life. Life everlasting. Would you give your life?